Larry Tye has been an award-winning journalist for the Boston Globe and a Nieman Fellow at Harvard University, and he now runs a Boston-based training program for medical journalists. But he's the author of several best-selling books, including Satchel, Superman, The Father of Spin, Homelands, and Rising... The Father of Spin, Homelands, and Rising from the Rails in Shock. He's also the author of a very important book about a very important American figure. It's called Bobby Kennedy, The Making of a Liberal Icon. Henry Kissinger noted that Tye's biography of Bobby draws on the personal papers and insights of the Kennedy family, and it inspires readers to understand the emotions of the times in which Bobby Kennedy lived. Evan Thomas, an author of best-selling books about Bobby Kennedy and Richard Nixon, says that in this fair, lively, and insightful biography of one of history's fascinating and elusive figures, Larry Tye makes Bobby real. Ladies and gentlemen, Larry Tye.
Thank you. Can I say that one thing Jonathan forgot to say is that I am a very difficult person to deal with, and I would love you to give him a round of applause for helping me set all of this up, because it wasn't fun. What I wanted to do, how many people here had any sense of Bobby Kennedy? Some of you are old enough to have been around when he was. Anybody have any connections to Bobby Kennedy? Lots of people do. So great. In a little bit, I'm going to call all of you up here to tell your Bobby stories. What I would like to do is start out by taking you to three moments in Bobby Kennedy's life that I think give a feel for Bobby Kennedy that is not the one that we generally think of when we think of who Bobby Kennedy was by the end of his life. And the first moment takes us back to 1957. And it's 1957 in a place called Appleton, Wisconsin. Anybody know anybody who was from Appleton, Wisconsin? Who was from Appleton? Somebody famous. Who was? From Appleton. So, Joe McCarthy. We're going back to Appleton because Joe McCarthy was from Appleton. And Joe McCarthy, we're going back the day that Joe McCarthy was being buried in Appleton, Wisconsin. And in the closest airport, which was in Green Bay, Wisconsin, at just before Joe McCarthy's funeral, an enormous plane lands at the airport in Green Bay. And off of this plane step 19 U.S. senators, 7 congressmen, and a whole bunch of other dignitaries. And those dignitaries did what dignitaries always do. They piled into big, black, stretched limousines, and they were whisked away to the funeral in Appleton. And at that point, the airport goes quiet, and it looks like the plane is empty. And when it looks like the plane is empty and the airport's about to shut down, one last, very solitary figure steps off the airplane. And it is a short, thin, congressional staffer named Robert Francis Kennedy, who was not the person you would expect to show up at Joe McCarthy's funeral. And in fact, Bobby's brother, a senator named John F. Kennedy, had told Bobby, you will stay away from that funeral. And Bobby did what most of us do with our older siblings telling us something. He listened to it, he said, that makes sense, and he did the opposite. Bobby Kennedy, at the church service, sat way up in the choir loft where nobody could see him. At the graveside service, all the dignitaries were over here, and Bobby Kennedy was way over there where nobody could see him. At the time when things were breaking up at the end of the funeral service, and lots of reporters were going around and writing down in their notebooks the names of all the important people who were at the funeral, Bobby Kennedy did what politicians did back then. He went up to those reporters and he said, excuse me, would you mind not mentioning that I was here? Now, politicians generally were obliging back then to reporters, and when the politician had a last name of Kennedy, they were especially obliging. And nobody mentioned, in all the funeral stories that mentioned just about everybody else who was there, nobody mentioned that Bobby Kennedy was there. So why do I tell you the story about Bobby Kennedy showing up at his funeral? I do it because I think it says two things about who the young Bobby Kennedy was back in 1957. The good thing that it says about him is that he was an incredibly loyal guy. And 5 or 6 years earlier, when Bobby Kennedy was a decidedly undistinguished graduate of anybody here from the University of Virginia? So I can say anything I want. When he was an undistinguished graduate of the University of Virginia Law School, which he went to because he didn't get into Harvard Law School, he didn't have a job. He had worked a couple quick jobs, he needed a job, and he went to work for a guy named Joe McCarthy because Joe McCarthy was Joseph P. Kennedy's great buddy. And Joe Kennedy had given enough money to McCarthy that when he called and said, hire my son, McCarthy said, it's done. But it wasn't just that he went to work for Joe McCarthy. He believed in what Joe McCarthy was doing back then. It was the early 1950s. The Soviet Union was a major threat, and Joe McCarthy thought that they were a threat not just in faraway Russia, but they were a threat in the State Department and other places in the American government. And Bobby Kennedy believed that Joe McCarthy was the only guy in Washington with the courage to stand up to the Soviet Union. So in what is written off by the Kennedy myth-making machine as an aberration or a footnote, it was in fact 7.5 months working in a very loyal way, in a very hardworking way, in very much believing in what Joe McCarthy was doing. So the fact that 5 or 6 years later, after McCarthy had been censured and most people had run away from him and every Democrat had run very far away from him, Bobby Kennedy was the loyal friend who was going to show up at the funeral no matter what his brother said. That's the nice Bobby Kennedy. The other Bobby Kennedy was the one who would become the great spinmeister, working for his brother's campaigns and doing whatever the dirty jobs were in the early days of the Kennedy administration. And that was a Bobby Kennedy who had gone to all those reporters and said, I had the loyalty to be here, but it would be good for me and it would be good for my brother if he didn't mention it. He was thinking about his brother's campaign in 3 years for president and best not have his brother associated in any way with Joe McCarthy. So two conflicting pieces of who Bobby Kennedy was then. One a more flattering, one a little bit less flattering. That's 1957. We're now going to jump ahead to 1963. And it's November 1963. And it's November 1963 in one of the nicest places outside of Washington, which is an estate called, anybody know the estate where Bobby lived? Hickory Hill. In what town? This is great. So I'm going to just ask questions in the... So it was in McLean, Virginia. It was just over the hill from the CIA, and Bobby and Ethel had a brilliant estate that was an old horse farm that they still had horses at. And Bobby Kennedy was doing what he often did. He had spent a hard morning working at the Justice Department, and he came back with a couple young staffers for a swim in his pool, for lunch, and to relax a bit before he went back to the Justice Department. And he had just gotten out of the swimming pool, put on dry clothes, and was sitting down to lunch when the telephone rang. And the telephone at poolside was not the normal poolside telephone. It was one of many hotlines to the White House that were there in the Hickory Hill estate. And by the way, I should tell you, much to the consternation of the vice president, there were more hotlines to the White House at Hickory Hill than there were in the vice president's residence. The phone rang, and that was generally not a good sign. Not good news when the hotline rings to the White House. Decidedly bad news when the guy on the other end of the phone was a guy named J. Edgar Hoover, the FBI director. And Ethel holds up the phone and says, Bobby, it's Hoover. His stomach had already begun to sink. When Hoover got on the phone, he said to Bobby words that Bobby would later describe as a monotone, as if Hoover was describing having found another communist on the faculty of Howard University. And Hoover says to Bobby, your brother has been shot. An hour or so later, a second call comes in and says, your brother is dead. In an instant, Bobby's life was transformed. He had lost his best friend, his boss, his brother, and his whole sense of what his life was all about. Ever since Jack Kennedy had run for Congress, Bobby Kennedy had been involved with Jack professionally. He had been involved in running his Senate campaign. He had run, as we all know, his presidential campaign. And we use a lot today a word that's become a cliche, co-president, as if any president would really ever give up the power to a vice president or anyone else. But when people are running for office, they often say, my equal partner here, this vice presidential choice, will be my co-president. Well, the closest thing America ever came to a co-presidency was when Bobby and Jack Kennedy were in the White House. He was not just Jack Kennedy's attorney general. He was the guy when real crunches came on foreign policy, Jack Kennedy was a whole lot more likely to consult Bobby Kennedy than he was his Secretary of State, Dean Rusk. When he had to worry that somebody had his back politically, the guy he trusted to do that was Bobby Kennedy. They were alter egos in a way that the loss was extraordinary. For the next month, though, something very magical happened. Bobby Kennedy rallied in a way that he knew he had to rally. He was, after all, with Joe Kennedy having had a stroke, Bobby was the head of the Kennedy clan. So right after he heard about Jack dying, he pointed to Ted Kennedy and he said, "You will go tell our parents." He pointed to Eunice Kennedy Shriver and he said, "You will start making the funeral plans." He was the one who pulled things together for the family. For the next month, he held Jackie and John John and Caroline's hands in a way that only Bobby Kennedy could to help them through this trauma of having lost their husband and their father. The country back then was shattered. It had lost its young president. And my guess is if I went around this room and talked to anybody with gray hair, they would remember precisely where they were at that moment when they heard about Jack Kennedy's death. It was for our generation what for a younger generation 9/11 was. It was that moment that was so traumatic that you just never forget what you were up to. And the country needed somebody to help them pull through for that next month. And America's mourner-in-chief was a guy named Robert Francis Kennedy. For a month, he held everybody together. At the end of that month, the Kennedy family started going back to work. America started getting focused on the fact that a guy named Lyndon Johnson was sitting in the East Room of the White House rather than Jack Kennedy, and they started to pull it together. At the end of a month, at that same month, Bobby Kennedy crashed. And he crashed in a way that today we would describe as serious clinical depression. He would ride around at night in his trademark convertible, going nowhere with the top down in the middle of winter. He would go to work at the Justice Department and not be able to focus on anything that was happening there in a way that was totally against the grain of the most focused attorney general we had ever had. He was without purpose. He thought about giving it all up and maybe going and teaching at a college. He thought about taking his $10 million inheritance and giving it up and going and traveling with what was then, I think, 7 or 8 kids. He didn't know what he wanted to do. He even had lost his focus at the moment that he had decided, what was Bobby Kennedy's next political move? What did he run for? Senator from where? Senator from the state where anybody who is looking for a place to run for senator from goes and moves to New York, and they can run for senator. They can call themselves a New York resident and run from senator from New York. And for the first month of that campaign when he was running for senator, he had again lost his focus. It wasn't until, I'm convinced, the magical moment for Bobby Kennedy pulling out of that depression was mid-October of 1964, when it looked like, for the first time ever, a Kennedy could actually lose an election. And that was enough to focus Bobby. He started to realize that people liked him, not just because he was Jack's kid brother and he had had this tragic loss, but because he was Bobby Kennedy. And at about that point in the campaign, the press started writing about these enormous crowds that would show up at every Bobby Kennedy rally. People would want a piece of his hair. They would want one of his cufflinks. They would pull off a shoe. They wanted some piece of Bobby Kennedy, and the standard press reference back then was he was the fifth Beatle. And for anybody who is not old enough to know what that meant, that was about the nicest compliment. You couldn't get more popular than the four Beatles. But this was a different Bobby Kennedy. So I don't pretend to know a whole lot about religion, but I would call his brother's assassination his epiphany moment. And the new Bobby Kennedy was somebody who was, instead of going out to relieve stress the way he historically had done, which was to go out and play a nose-bloodying game of touch football, he would start burying himself in his bedroom reading Greek tragedy. Now, Jackie Kennedy was the one who told him that the Greeks had a story worth reading about. And I think he was reading Greek tragedy because he saw in the Greek story the Kennedy story. He saw the story of hubris, and he saw the story of tragic loss. And that was what he had lived through. If I went around and interviewed everybody in this room, I think I would find that you were all some combination of tough and tender. But the Bobby Kennedy who had been, it had the dial pointing to the direction of toughness in 1957, starting in 1963, it started moving more to the tender side. He started not just understanding the Greeks, but understanding underdogs. And he started becoming a more compassionate human being. So we were in 1957 to start out with. We saw how Bobby Kennedy was transformed in 1963 with the death of his brother. And the last moment that I want to take you to was 1968. And my guess is, again, that everybody in this room who's old enough remembers what happened with the presidential race in 1968. Anybody remember at what point Bobby jumped into that race? What happened? It was after one particular primary. Do you remember what primary that was? Well, this was actually early on. It was New Hampshire. So what happened was Gene McCarthy, when you added in the Democratic votes in the Democratic primary and then the Republican write-in votes for a Democrat, Gene McCarthy beat this unknown, largely unknown senator from Minnesota, actually beat a sitting president, Lyndon Johnson. McCarthy running as the anti-war candidate. And that was extraordinary. And it was extraordinary for two reasons. One is because it was a victory that nobody had expected McCarthy to earn. And the other was because exactly 4 days after that victory, Bobby Kennedy jumped into the race. And to America, that looked like the old Bobby Kennedy, the ruthless Bobby Kennedy. And in one sort of symbolic message delivered after he did that, a columnist, and I think it was Murray Kempton, wrote a telegram to Ted Kennedy saying, "Your brother's entry into this presidential race proves that St. Patrick didn't drive all the snakes out of Ireland." Not exactly the way you wanted to open a campaign, especially if you were trying to run away from that image of being ruthless. The truth is always more interesting, but we never find out about the truth until much later. And the truth is that Bobby Kennedy, 9 days before the New Hampshire primary, had made an incontrovertible decision to jump into the New Hampshire primary. But he knew that McCarthy had been there for months fighting against LBJ in New Hampshire. And he thought it would look ruthless if he jumped in before McCarthy got his shot. So McCarthy gets his shot, he wins, Bobby jumps in, and it makes him look ruthless when in fact it should have made him look ham-handed. But the last thing he was ruthless with that move. But I want to take you a little bit before. Our last moment is on one particular night in that New Hampshire, in the presidential campaign in 1968, and it's in the month of April. And it's the first primary that Bobby Kennedy contested in 1968. Nobody happens to remember what state he went in. Not Wisconsin. So Wisconsin's very good, but Wisconsin would have been the answer if I was asking about Jack Kennedy. That was his first. Bobby was Indiana. So a state that a guy who grew up in luxury in Massachusetts, you know how much he knew about Indiana? He had no idea where the food on his table came from, and the fact that some of it came from Indiana was a mystery to him. He had no idea how conservative Indiana, after all, was the birthplace of the John Birch Society, and Indiana had an editor of the biggest papers in Indiana who hated the Kennedys. And Bobby Kennedy didn't know what he was getting himself into in running as his first primary in the state of Indiana. And he goes to Indiana, he campaigns hard, and one night in April of 1968, Bobby Kennedy lands his plane, or somebody lands his plane, in Indianapolis, and when he gets off the plane, waiting for him are a couple young aides and a guy named Richard Lugar, who became a powerful senator and was then the mayor of Indianapolis. And they have horrible news for him. They say Martin Luther King has been shot and killed. Lugar goes on to say, "I know you have a rally planned tonight in the middle of the black ghetto, and you will have to cancel your rally. Because if you go in there tonight, I can't guarantee that you'll come out alive, and I can't guarantee that you won't set off a riot." And Bobby Kennedy says to Luger the same thing he said to Jack when Jack told him not to go to the funeral. He says, "Nice advice, thank you, but I'm going." He drives into the ghetto in Indianapolis, and he has his police escort peel off just before he gets there. He jumps up on the back of a flatbed truck, and for the next 5 minutes, he delivers what might have been in the history of America the most poignant speech that a white politician has ever delivered to a minority community. He gets up there and he says he's telling most people for the first time that Martin Luther King has been shot and killed. And you can hear in a 5-minute YouTube video from that night, you can hear people saying, "Oh no," and "What happened?" and just the trauma in the audience. He proceeds to tell them, "I lost somebody very close to me." And he can't make himself say the name Jack or my brother, but he has never talked publicly about what he felt with the loss of his brother, and this night he decides he has to do it. He says, "When you lose somebody like that in this tragic way to violence, your first instinct is to want to strike out and anybody who's around to strike out against them. But this has to be a moment for us where we come together as a country and as individuals." He goes into the ghetto that night to try to embrace the community with its loss. And instead, something magical happens, which is the community embraces him. They see this frail, small-looking politician up there talking about losing somebody even closer to him than people had lost their great civil rights leader. That night in America, in more than 100 cities, anybody who's old enough, you will remember that there were race riots. You may remember that in the city of Washington, a good piece of the black community was burned down that night. There was one major city in America with a sizable African-American population which did not riot, did not have any violence that night, and that city was Indianapolis. And the reason was Robert Francis Kennedy. I tell you this story now for a couple reasons. One is because I think it says who Bobby had become by the end of his campaign. He was easily the most popular white man in black America for the rest of his life. When he would campaign in ghettos across the country, the same sign would turn up. And that sign said, very simply, "White, but all right." Now, that may not sound like much, but that was more than anybody would have held up a sign saying about any other white politician campaigning in their midst. But I tell you this story for a reason that has to do with what's going on today in 2016. And that reason is, in the wake of Baton Rouge, in the wake of what happened in Dallas, every politician of any stature in America has been looking for the right words on how to address the racial divide in America, how to address the pain of the police with their losses, and how to address the pain of the black community with their losses. And lots of people, from Donald Trump to Hillary Clinton to Barack Obama, have tried. Barack Obama came the closest of anybody with a 45-minute speech he gave in the funeral of the Dallas police officers. His 45 minutes, if you listen to them and you listen to Bobby Kennedy, still didn't come close to what Bobby Kennedy had managed in his 5 minutes. And I think he managed that night in Indianapolis because he had become a very different Bobby Kennedy than he started out as. He had become the one word that I think will decide who wins this presidential election. And the word is the candidate who seems to the American people the most authentic. Bobby Kennedy, by the end of the campaign in 1968, was going in, the only politician that I can think of in my lifetime who did this as compellingly. He was delivering the same speech when he spoke to white audiences and black audiences. He told both of them, "We need, number one, safety in our streets. And the only way we're going to get safety in our streets is to have racial justice." He went in and told audiences of young students, young, wealthy, comfortable students who were out there supporting the Vietnam War because they had in their back pockets draft deferments because they were students. He told them exactly what they didn't want to hear, which was, if they supported the war, they should be ready to go to the war. He told wealthy young medical students who were asking, who's going to pay for all these health programs? He said to them, you are. He went in and did precisely the opposite of what a politician does. He told people what they didn't want to hear. And there were two possible reactions when you tell somebody what they don't want to hear. Either they tune off to you and they say, that's a guy we'd never vote for, or they're so shocked that the politician would actually tell them a tough truth that they did what I think was happening in 1968 in places like California where he won the primary. People were so unused to being told the truth that they thought, this guy must be authentic. So what I want to do now is end with telling you one thing that I think, and I don't know what the politics of everybody in this room are, and it doesn't matter. We're here in the Richard Nixon Library, which was generous enough to have me in. It's the first blatantly Republican setting that I've talked about with my book, but I think Bobby has a message for people in any political setting. And what he was on the verge of becoming when he died that tragic night in the Ambassador Hotel nearby here, not the hotel, because the hotel's gone, but the setting nearby here that night of his greatest political victory, the night he won the California primary, he was on the verge of becoming what I again think we are looking for today in America. And you can take your choice of the phrase. I'm going to give you two options depending on your particular politics. He was either on his way to becoming the tough liberal that many of us have been dreaming about for 50 years, or the truly tender conservative. But whichever version it is, he was on the way to doing something quite unique. He was not a saint, and I don't want to ever suggest that he, I had, half my book is filled with his flaws, but the other half suggests that he was on the way to becoming something very special at that moment. So what I would like to do now is stop talking and see if people have stories or questions or anything else, and if not, you've been a great audience. So thank you, and we'll see. We've got a mic.
Thank you, Larry. Larry has agreed to answer your questions, but I first want to say that he's happy to meet every one of you and sign copies of Bobby Kennedy after the lecture. I'd like to first ask you, you talked about Bobby changing over the course of his political career. In 1968, if he had been elected, do you think he would have differed all that much from John F. Kennedy as president?
Yes. So can I take that question back one step? The first step is, would Bobby Kennedy have been the nominee and would he have been the president? And I assume everybody in this room has their own opinion, and I can say anything because we'll never know. But I want to suggest to you what was about to happen the day after Bobby Kennedy won that California primary. Bobby Kennedy was on his way to Chicago, and the son of the very powerful, then very powerful mayor, Richard Daley, tells me that it was almost a certainty that his dad was going to endorse Bobby Kennedy the next day. And if you remember back to 1968, there was nobody who carried more weight in the Democratic establishment than Richard Daley. And you'll also remember that Bobby Kennedy's primary opponent, his major opponent at that point, was not Gene McCarthy. Beating McCarthy in California was the end of McCarthy's insurgency. The real opponent was Hubert Humphrey. And Hubert Humphrey entered exactly this many primaries and got exactly this many votes. And I think the establishment, especially with people rallying around him, like Richard Daley, would have had a very difficult time nominating Hubert Humphrey over Bobby Kennedy. But I suggest to you the ticket would have been one of two things on the Democratic side, because this is what Democrats and Republicans did back then. It would have either been Bobby Kennedy, Hubert Humphrey, which is what I think the ticket would have looked like, or it would have been Hubert Humphrey, Bobby Kennedy. Bobby Kennedy was willing to take a second spot on a ticket 4 years before with a guy he detested named Lyndon Johnson. And he would have definitely, to beat Richard Nixon, he would have taken the second spot on a ticket with Humphrey. And had it been a Kennedy versus Nixon campaign, which is what Richard Nixon said in his memoir that he expected it was going to be, who knows what would have happened, but I'm going to tell you what I think would have happened. And I'm sorry to say it in this room, but there was nobody in America who understood Richard Nixon's vulnerabilities better than Bobby Kennedy, who had beat him on behalf of his brother as his campaign manager 8 years before. And he was aching to take on, he wanted to show that in the course of 8 years, two guys named Kennedy could beat Richard Nixon. Now, that would have been a tough fought campaign, and it would have been a very closely fought campaign. And it would have been a campaign that had every high ground and low ground that we've ever seen in American politics. You know where Richard Nixon had a horrible nickname that he hated, which was people, Tricky Dick. You know where Richard Nixon rightfully said that he learned how to play hardball politics. It was from a guy named Bobby Kennedy in 1960. And Richard Nixon was a very smart student of politics, and he saw what Bobby Kennedy did. And this would have been the hardest fought campaign if you thought 1960 was a tough campaign. But none of this is answering your question. So Jonathan, the question is, what would Bobby Kennedy have been like and how different would he have been than Jack Kennedy? And I want to tell you that Rose Kennedy's dream was that one of her sons would go into the priesthood. That was, she was a very devout Catholic. You remember Rose Kennedy, who lived to be 302 and went to church 23 times a day, and she was very devout in her faith, and she thought that one of her sons should become a priest. Well, if Jack Kennedy had become a priest, he would have been the Pope, because that was who Jack Kennedy was. He always wanted to be in charge. He was above things. He was an intellectual. If Bobby Kennedy had been a priest, he would have been a parish priest. That was who he was. He got down at ground level, and that was the way he grew and learned and developed. He wasn't as intellectual and may not have been as smart as his brother, but he had a very different and much more activist personality. And Jack Kennedy said in 1962 and 1963, when people would ask him the tough questions, when are you going to give us a strong civil rights bill? When are you going to fire J. Edgar Hoover as FBI director? Jack Kennedy's standard answer was, in 1964, when I win re-election, I will do all those hard things. Bobby Kennedy, on day one of his presidency, would have fired J. Edgar Hoover, would have given us an even tougher civil rights bill. He had no patience, he had endless passion, and he knew, having lost three siblings, that you should never lose at that young an age. He knew how tender and how short-lived life could be. So he would have been an exceedingly different president, and I think that he was so much better prepared than his brother to be president. Jack Kennedy served a very relatively short and quite undistinguished career in the U.S. Senate. Bobby Kennedy served an even shorter and hugely more distinguished career in the Senate. He had been Attorney General, he had been pseudo Secretary of State, he had been a congressional staff aide, he knew how to get things done, and he would have tried on day one. So we would have had a very different president than Jack Kennedy, and we would have had a very different president than Richard Nixon. And that's a longer-winded answer than you wanted, but the...
Our next question.
Larry, it's a great book, a great story, and an enjoyable read. Struck by many things, but one is the relationship of the press with, not to, but with Bobby Kennedy. Like you mentioned the McCarthy funeral, and then also mentioned in passing that reporters were hanging out at Hickory Hill. I mean, totally different from what today is, and as a journalist yourself, better then, better now.
So I want to just give you one quick story about Bobby's relationship with the press. He spent much of his life having a relationship with the press that was not dissimilar to Donald Trump's and Hillary Clinton, a very contentious relationship. He lied to the press a lot. He told the press in 1960 that his brother didn't have a serious disease when his brother had Addison's disease. He told the world in his book, 13 Days, that he was always a dove during the Cuban Missile Crisis when he started out. And we know what I'm about to say, not because I'm telling you this, but because he and his brother were secretly taping the cabinet room, and those tapes became public years later. We know he didn't start out as a dove, that he wanted to bomb the hell out of Cuba, and that it was only later in day 6 or 7 or whatever it was that he became a dove. So he had a contentious relationship for understandable reasons, and the press didn't trust him, and he didn't trust them. In 1968, something magical happened. And the magical was that he had become a different person. And there was one reporter who reflected his new relationship with the press. And it was a guy who Ben Bradley of the Washington Post assigned to cover the campaign for the Washington Post. And this guy's name was Richard Harwood. You may know on CNBC his son John Harwood today. Richard Harwood was assigned by Ben Bradley because he was a rhinoceros-hided ex-Marine who Ben Bradley knew would not be wooed by this Kennedy magic. He's out there, supposed to cover the campaign. His first experience with Bobby Kennedy was playing touch football with him. Harwood came back with a bloody nose, and he was convinced that Bobby Kennedy was deceptive in his politics and was a cheater on the football field. So that made him hate him even more. Started out totally predisposed against Bobby Kennedy. And then he watched what we were talking about before. He watched Bobby give the same speech in the black and white community. He watched him develop in the course of that campaign to the point where he could deliver speeches like he did when Martin Luther King died. Near the end of the campaign, before Bobby died, Richard Harwood goes to Ben Bradley and he says, "Boss, you gotta take me off the campaign. I've fallen in love with Bobby Kennedy." Now, Ben Bradley, who had fallen in love with the Kennedys 10 years before, said, "No, you've gotta stick it out here and you're gonna stay." The most eloquent of all the eulogies written for and delivered on behalf of Bobby was written and delivered by Richard Harwood. And that suggests how Bobby Kennedy turned it around. And I wrote a very boring series of op-eds, including on the eve of the Democratic Convention in the Philadelphia Inquirer, suggesting that Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump could learn a lot from what Bobby Kennedy did with the press. Donald Trump's approach to the press is to bash them and then banish them from his campaign. Hillary Clinton's approach is what I call the Duck and Perry approach. They both are disserving, I think, themselves, but more importantly, the public. Whether you like reporters or don't like us as human beings, we are the filter between what the candidates say and what you read or hear the next day. And the only way we're really going to get to the essence of who these candidates really are is by them sitting down and having some relationship, as if pretending they're human beings on both sides, talking to and listening to the press. And Bobby Kennedy showed that you could come from those never do it to the do it in a way that nobody's done it since. And I think he offers us a role model for lots of things. And yeah, I should have just said yes and good. And that was what he was, because he did it.
We have a question towards the back row.
First, I just think the most, you brought eulogy to mind, and I think Ted Kennedy's eulogy to Robert Kennedy brings tears to my eyes every time I think about it. It's very moving, and it feels, brings me closer to Robert Kennedy hearing that eulogy. But my question is, what sort of a controversy did it stir when young President Kennedy appointed his younger brother as Attorney General?
Yes. So I want to say two things about that. One is that you mentioned Ted Kennedy. Ted Kennedy, as we know, served for nearly 50 years in the U.S. Senate. And he was known at the end of his life as the Lion of the Senate. And I think Ted Kennedy spent those 50 years in the Senate trying to do one thing, which was to be Bobby. Bobby was his role model, much more than Jack Kennedy was. And Ted, by the end, had become Bobby. He had this sort of instinctual sense of what to do. The question about appointing his brother Attorney General. Bobby Kennedy was, in the history of America, the third youngest Attorney General ever. He was, in the history of America, arguably the least qualified person ever named to be Attorney General to be Attorney General. He'd never tried a case in a court of law. He was young, he was green. His main qualification was having been Jack's campaign manager. His main reason for appointing him, Jack's main reason, was not that he wanted him to be Attorney General. It was that Joe Kennedy said, "You gotta appoint him." And Jack was willing, at the point that he was the president-elect, to stand up to however many Americans, if there were 240 million Americans, he was willing to stand up to all but one of them, and that one was Joe Kennedy. And when Joe said, "You will do it," Bobby's earned it, he did it. So having told you how unqualified he was to be Attorney General, I want to just take the story one step further. Nobody in the history of the Justice Department went after organized crime like Bobby Kennedy did. Nobody in the history of the Justice Department went after corrupt unions like the Teamsters Union. Nobody in the history of the Justice Department put the word justice back next to department in a way that it meant something in terms of understanding that it wasn't just as a chief law enforcement officer. He tried to reform the bail system. He tried to ensure truly equal justice for Americans. He was the least qualified to start with, and by the end, I would argue strongly that he was the most qualified and the most effective attorney general, if not in all of American history, than in modern America. And to just give you one piece of evidence, because you shouldn't, I'm a journalist, and you shouldn't believe what I tell you just because I tell it to you. There are two attorneys general more than any others who use Bobby Kennedy as their role model. One was not surprisingly named Eric Holder, the longest serving attorney general under Barack Obama. The other was an attorney general named John Ashcroft, who was so enamored with Bobby Kennedy that he renamed the Justice Department the Robert F. Kennedy Department of Justice. people ranging from Karl Rove to Che Guevara, and I'm just joking about Che Guevara, but not about Karl Rove, grew up with Bobby Kennedy as one of their role models. He was, depending on what time in his history you were looking at him, he was a hero to today's leading conservatives and to the leading liberals. And that's because Bobby Kennedy was some combination of Machiavelli and Che Guevara. He was everything at one point in his life. And I think that he was a terrific attorney general and that his brother was either prescient or lucky. And I think maybe more lucky.
We have a question right here.
I have actually two questions. One, why did he hate LBJ?
You're supposed to say I have one question and slip in the second one.
But yeah, Why did he hate LBJ? Yeah, right. And second, what was his position on the Vietnam War in 1968?
But the first one, question.
Why did he? You said Bobby Kennedy hated LBJ.
So Bobby Kennedy in his life had four people that he truly detested more than anybody else. One was a guy named Roy Cohn, who we remember was Joe McCarthy's young aide, and at a senior part of his life, Roy Cohn was Donald Trump's tutor. He hated Roy Cohn, and he hated Roy Cohn because Roy Cohn was his boss. And Roy Cohn and Bobby Kennedy there was something constitutionally that they despised one another. He hated Jimmy Hoffa because he thought Jimmy Hoffa was corrupt. And in fact, Bobby Kennedy and Jimmy Hoffa were a whole lot alike, and neither could see the strength in one another. And the first night that they met was at a private dinner party that somebody had invited them both to. And at the end of the night, the way they both tell the story, so maybe it's true, they got down on the floor and arm wrestled. That was the kind of tough guys that each of them were, neither one wanting to give an inch to the other. The third person Bobby Kennedy hated was J. Edgar Hoover. And anybody who knows the history of Hoover and the information he was gathering on the Kennedys and all of that, there were lots of reasons to hate J. Edgar Hoover for Bobby Kennedy. The guy that was the most unlikely guy that he hated was Lyndon Johnson. And there was something from the very moment they met, the first time in the Senate cafeteria when Johnson was a young senator and Bobby Kennedy was an aide to Gene McCarthy, there was something, again, like two dogs, the hair standing up on the back of their neck, and they despised one another. And I think it was because Bobby Kennedy was what Johnson called a Harvard. And I'm not saying it with a proper accent, but I mean, if I could say it with a Kennedy accent, it would really, but he despised anybody from that sort of elite East Coast world. And Bobby Kennedy didn't get East Texas poor. And they just came from different worlds. Bobby didn't want LBJ to be Jack's vice president. He did everything he could to put down Johnson for the 3 years that Jack Kennedy was president. And Johnson did everything he could to pay him back for that when he took over the White House. And they just despised one another. The second question was Vietnam. So Bobby Kennedy, in the 1950s, when Jack Kennedy was touring the world, and especially Asia, to sort of prepare his portfolio for running for president, they visited Vietnam, and Bobby was all for what the French were trying to do in Vietnam. As an early member of the Kennedy administration advising his brother, he was all for standing up, using Vietnam as a place where we were going to stand up to the communists. You remember back then, the thought was it was a domino. And Bobby Kennedy thought the way we stopped the dominoes was to stand in Vietnam. As long as the Vietnamese in the South were willing to fight, we would be behind them. Bobby Kennedy was one of the authors of the counterinsurgency strategy. He loved the idea of all these Vietnamese communists running around in black pajamas. And he thought the way we fight them was to learn how to do exactly what they were doing, which is infiltrate quietly and do all those kinds of things. Shortly after he became a U.S. senator, with his buddy, the Secretary of Defense, Robert McNamara, Bobby Kennedy started to have his doubts. And every doubt that McNamara had, he would feed to Bobby Kennedy. And by 1966, Bobby Kennedy decided that we were wrong on Vietnam. This was a point when most of the country still believed we were right on Vietnam. LBJ had been overwhelmingly reelected, so he was not going with the political winds, he was going ahead of the political winds. He stood up and did something that almost nobody does in the U.S. Senate. He said, I was wrong. And that made his opposition to the war credible enough that he became instantaneously the head of the congressional and the head of the national movement to stop the war. And that was, more than anything, the reason why he ended up challenging Lyndon Johnson. One last thing, uniting your two questions. Bobby Kennedy was totally convinced that Lyndon Johnson
would have gotten us out of Vietnam more quickly and would have mellowed in his pro-war stance if the guy leading the movement on the other side wasn't Bobby Kennedy. And it was one of the many tragedies of their relationship. They couldn't come together on the war. They would have been the most effective duo in the history of America in fighting for civil rights and against poverty, and yet they hated one another so much that instead of becoming allies, they became these enemies.
We have a question in the third row.
Hi, my name is Jinx Hackring, and Larry, I talked to you while you were writing your book.
Great.
And I'm here tonight with a friend of mine, Carol Gaynor, and we had the distinct pleasure, I worked for Ethel Kennedy at Hickory Hill. And hearing Larry's stories reminds me, I'm just going to tell one story about the change that happened that I observed with Bobby Kennedy, Senator Kennedy, as I called him then. He went to Appalachia. My first boss in the office was a man named Peter Edelman, of whom you might have heard. And he married a woman named Marion Wright Edelman, who became the head of the Children's Defense Fund. But she was instrumental in getting Senator Kennedy to go into Appalachia and to see the extreme poverty that was down there. And as Larry was saying, it was that gentle, soft, compassionate man who saw this incredible poverty there. And I was at home, I was working at Hickory Hill when he came back from that trip, and he talked to his children, and he talked to me and to Carol about what he had seen and how horrible it was that there was such poverty in the United States. And he challenged his children all the time to look for the justice, to look to make the world a better place. And I just can't tell you how much fun it is. It's like a sentimental journey. It reminds me how much I miss the man to this very day.
So that is a wonderful story. And Jinx, so one of the great joys of writing a book like this, I interviewed more than 400 people, and it's a great joy when you go around and talk about the book and connect a face to a voice that you talk to on the phone. And I want to just add, she told the story so movingly that I'm just going to add one tiny piece. And the piece is, when Bobby Kennedy was in the Mississippi Delta looking at that poverty, so all the senators who had heard about the poverty, with the exception of one other, went back to Washington. And Bobby said, I want to see what you're telling me about. And he goes to the Mississippi Delta, and he goes to one shack in particular during his tour of the Delta. And when he thinks nobody's around, he thinks no journalists are watching him, he gets down on the floor in his business suit with a toddler in a shack that is poor enough that it had a clothesline in the living room, it had a jar of peanut butter in the refrigerator, and had a toddler sitting on the floor playing with his cornmeal with a distended stomach that suggested that this was a malnourished child. For the next 15 minutes, Bobby Kennedy, at eye level with this child, tried to make some contact, to get some response out of this child. Nobody could see, because he thought nobody was watching, only somebody was, the flies flying around the child, the tears coming down the senator's face. To suggest that there was no other senator that I know of who would have gotten down on the floor with this child, some might have gone and looked at the shack. Nobody would have done that John Steinbeck kind of contact. So he goes back to Washington and he does two things. One is, he goes to see the next Monday the Secretary of Agriculture named Orville Freeman. And he says, Orville, there are people starving in America. And Orville Freeman says, no, we've got a food stamp program. Nobody is starving. And Bobby says, well, you don't understand that people have to buy food stamps. And even though it's only a buck or two to buy them, there are people with zero income. Freeman agrees that he will send his young aide with Peter Edelman back to Mississippi. And if Edelman can convince his aide that there are people with no income who are starving, that he will change the rules to food stamps. He changed the rules to food stamps. There were fewer people starving in America thanks to Bobby Kennedy's trip. The second thing he did was precisely what Jinx did. What Jinx said he did. He went back to his enormous estate at Hickory Hill on a Sunday afternoon, and he gave his kids a speech that was so profound that at my first book talk, I am a diehard, lifelong Boston Red Sox fan. So the dream setting for the first book talk was at Fenway Park. They have something called the Writer Series there. And at Fenway Park, they got a nice crowd like this, and at the back of the room, which I didn't notice when I started my talk, was a young woman who was close to Bobby Kennedy named Kathleen Kennedy Townsend, his oldest daughter. And I was telling this story about the trip to Mississippi, And I handed the microphone to her, and I said to her, I'd like you to tell us what Bobby said when he came back that day. She recited verbatim the speech that he gave to his children, saying, you are living in a room, you are eating dinner in a room that is the size of a house that 15 people are living in the Mississippi Delta. You have a responsibility in your life to figure out a way to give back, because you've been given everything and you've been asked nothing. And the kids have, to a greater or lesser extent, tried to live by that. But it was such a profound speech to them that exactly 50 years later, she could recite it verbatim. And so everything Jinx said is true. Part of what I'm saying is true. And do we have more?
Thank you. Just to go back on your comment regarding the Bobby's decision to support more of the anti-war movement than perhaps Lyndon's devotion to the Civil Rights Act. I was just wondering, again, you mentioned there's two Bobbies here. Which Bobby decided not to maybe help Lyndon continue his brother's legacy, which when he introduced that legislation, and perhaps we recently saw the movie All the Way, where it mentions about how Lyndon was literally working the phones, getting senators, congressmen, everybody behind this bill. But there's no ever mention about either Bobby volunteering or even Lyndon maybe asking Bobby, can you give us a hand?
Sure. So two quick answers to that. The first is that Bobby, in fact, did help. And Lyndon Johnson enlisted. The one time the two of them came together was to fight for the Civil Rights Bill. This was a bill that Jack Kennedy didn't want to introduce, that Bobby pushed him to introduce, and that Lyndon Johnson did something that only Lyndon Johnson could do, which was he realized, on the one hand, having Bobby Kennedy on his side on a bill like this would dredge up all of people's nostalgic feelings to Jack Kennedy, and it would help the bill win passage. And the other thing, the brilliant politician in Lyndon Johnson realized that if the bill lost, he could blame Bobby. And so he did it quite brilliantly. They worked together on that. But in fairness to Lyndon Johnson, so that's a good Bobby story. I want to tell you a story of the bad Bobby, and it's something that is never discussed. Lyndon Johnson, I'm convinced, stayed in Vietnam for lots of reasons. And one is, and he used to say this, that he thought that the lesson of the Cuban Missile Crisis was that America stood firm and we were tough and we made the Soviets back down in Cuba. All we had to do was tell them, we're going to blockade you, and they took their missiles out. And nobody ever told Lyndon Johnson two pieces of that story that only Bobby Kennedy knew and a few cabinet members, but that Lyndon was written out of. The first was that one of the reasons the Russians and the Cubans put the missiles in Cuba in the first place was because it was a year-long war, a secret war called Operation Mongoose, that Bobby Kennedy had been leading against Castro and the Cuban regime to try to destabilize the regime and maybe to try to kill Fidel Castro. And so it wasn't out of the blue, but it was for a specific reason that he put the missiles in there. The next thing that I'm about to tell you, we only knew, not because I'm telling you, but because about 10 years ago or 15 years ago, Robert McNamara told this story in Cuba. And the story is that instead of it being a unilateral move by the Soviets to take the missiles out, because we stood tough the way Johnson tried to do in Vietnam, we made an explicit quid pro quo. We would take our Jupiter missiles out of Turkey, they would take their missiles out. But Bobby Kennedy, and this was in Dobrynin, the Russian ambassador's memoir, Bobby Kennedy told the Russians on behalf of his brother, this has to be kept a secret. We will take our missiles out of Cuba months after you take them out of Cuba, and it has to be looked like two separate things. Our goodwill gesture after you've done a unilateral gesture. One of the things Bobby, according to Dobrynin, said was, you have to do this because we'll look bad and because someday I might run for president myself. There was always the tough, hard Bobby and the good, tender Bobby, and just, this was in the 1960s, pre-Jack's death, and as we talked, the dial was changing.
We have a question in the back row.
I recall in reading news articles in the late 60s, around 67, 68, that Bobby Kennedy and Los Angeles Mayor Sam Yorty were feuding. Do you have any details on that?
So the short answer is yes, absolutely, they were feuding. Some people have blamed Bobby's not having sufficient security that night on the fact that the mayor and the police chief really disliked Bobby. I think it was more complicated, and I talk in the book about what happened, but they hated one another. Can I just say a quick word, since we're in the Richard Nixon Library? Nobody's asked about Richard Nixon's relationship to Bobby. And they were, while they were declared enemies forever, they started out politically not that dissimilar. They were both Joe McCarthy, anti-communists, who believed, like much of America did back then, that that was a really serious threat. And they were two of the smartest political figures in American history of that era. And I would have loved to have been there. My guess is that they had contacts that none of us will ever know about behind the scenes at some point, pre-election or whatever. On the surface, it looked like their relationship was one of extraordinary tension. But we were talking earlier in the back here, before I came out, whether there were sort of fun, warm Richard Nixon and Bobby Kennedy stories. And I never heard of a fun, warm one, but they were probably there somewhere. So I want to just tell you a quick, less fun, warm one, which is sort of one of my favorites. This was the Bobby Kennedy at his toughest moment. Everybody remembers the 1960 presidential debates, the first of these big presidential debates. And Richard Nixon was about to go set up, you know, ready for the debate to begin. And he had just come off an operation, knee surgery or something. He'd been in the hospital. He looked terrible. He had the famous 5 o'clock shadow. And he goes up to Bobby Kennedy, and he says, "How do I look?" And Bobby Kennedy said, either wonderful or marvelous, you know, knowing that he didn't look either. Jack Kennedy is about to go out on the same thing, and I can't say the last word in this audience, but he said, "Kick him somewhere." That was his last minute advice to, and Bobby was in those days, he had three totems in his life that defined his life. One is he was a Catholic, and he was a serious Catholic. He was a more serious Catholic than anybody but Rose Kennedy in that family. The second was he was a Democrat, and we saw the Democrat that night telling his brother to go kick Nixon somewhere. And the third was, the most serious totem of all that defined who he was, is he was a Kennedy, in exactly the way that Joe Kennedy had intended him to be. And Joe Kennedy declared him the executor of his estate, and he never officially declared it, but he declared him, in all but name, the head of the Klan. When Joe had his stroke, it was Bobby who saw them through everything, and that was a tough guy, and it was, but it was a really important thing. We had a question here and a story.
And I worked, Jinx and I both worked at Hickory Hill. It was a very magical thing for both of us, and we always have a hashtag, best job ever. But there's a fun side you're talking about, the contrast. In September 1966, there was a Time magazine cover with the senator on it. We called him the senator at the House. And he was very gray in the picture. I'm sure you've seen it. And it came to the House, and he came in from the Senate in his white Bonneville convertible, drives it on the lawn, comes in, and I held it up and said, "Look, you know, here's the new Time magazine." And he came over to look at the cover, and he goes, "Well, what do you think of it?" You know, and I said, "Oh, it's so gray. That's not you. Why did they make a picture like that?" He's going, "No, the tough, ruthless," and he starts naming these qualities that the media always attributes to him, and we're like, we know him from at home. You know, he's coming in to get his piece of chocolate cake, and he's gonna, and we know this whole other part. And so we laughed about it, and then I went on doing what I did, and he went off with his family. And the next morning when I came into work, on my desk was that copy of his copy of the magazine, you know, written to me. And it says to Carol, "This is the way I look after a day at home." And he signed it. So, I mean, there was a side, a light and sweet side. I'm going to do one more thing here. And I'm wearing this now. Maybe you've seen this. This is the loyalty pill. This is the pill. And that came out of Hickory Hill because the people who worked for him were loyal, and the women didn't get the credit, I think, that the men got. And the loyalty and the staying up late at night and showing up on the weekend and doing that, it was the passion of the people working for him that believed in him. I'm getting really emotional. And we did believe in him very much. He was the real thing. And, you know, even though we were young in our 20s, you knew and I knew. And we made this, and I'm wearing it now. On one side, it says, it's a gold pill. Like, on one side, it says one a day, RFK, and the other side it says loyal, both ways like a Bayer aspirin. And I don't think there's only about 10 of these in the world.
So that is great, and one of the joys in writing a book like this is to get to talk to people and have them tell stories like the two people you just heard from. And the good news to me was that I got to more than 400 of them. The bad news was that in the course of the 3 years I spent on this book, a quarter to a third of them are no longer around. And it was a unique experience to me. I've been a hard-nosed reporter for a long time and writing books for a long time, and I've never had an experience like I did in interviewing these 400 people where easily half of them at some point during the interview cried. And they cried not because I was hard-nosed and mean to them, although I might have been that. They cried because it was even people like these two who have gone on and done brilliant things, that was a magical moment 50 years ago that nothing they could ever do would ever quite, and I'm talking about people who went on to become Attorney General of the United States. There was something magical about that time working with Bobby Kennedy, and there was a moment of hope. And there was never a place where that moment reached a peak the way it did that night in June of 1968 here in California, where the real hope was when he was leaving the stage. You know what happened that night with, so there, I want to end by telling two very quick stories about that night that you may or may not know. One is a story that somebody just told me a few days ago. When you write a book, you have people calling and saying, you should have talked to me, because here was a story better than anything you had in your book. And one was a story that made me cry. That night, so Bobby Kennedy is on the stage, and he delivers his extraordinary speech and goes like this, and we're on to Chicago, and we're on to win the presidency, he thought. He comes off the stage. He goes, as you know, into the kitchen of the Ambassador Hotel, and that's where he is shot and killed. He hangs on for a while, but a couple days later, he dies. And watching that night, this play out, and there were various versions of this that I've heard told by his siblings, but nobody knew the real version until this one person who was the nanny for the kids that night, in the younger kids in their hotel room. All of the kids were asleep but one, and that one was a middle child who I went to high school with named David Kennedy. And David Kennedy was watching on television, and he watched his father give the speech, he watched him go into the kitchen, and 5 minutes later he watched somebody come to the microphone and say he's been shot. This nanny, there were two nannies on duty that night, and this one spent a lot of time right after that walking around and around the hotel with David Kennedy saying the fact that he's been shot doesn't necessarily, he could be okay. And David Kennedy, who was about 11 years old then, says to him, no, Uncle Jack was shot and he died. My daddy's going to die. David Kennedy, years later, dies of a drug overdose. And I'm convinced that David Kennedy never got over the night, the shock of that night at that hotel room. The one other story I want to tell of that night is, so Bobby Kennedy had one bodyguard. He had a couple big football players, Roosevelt Greer and I'm blanking on, Rafer Johnson. A couple big football players who were with him when he went into the kitchen, but they were unarmed. And he had one guard. He had one security guy with him in the whole campaign, and a man named Bill Berry, an ex-FBI agent who carried a gun. And instead of being with Bobby in the kitchen that night, and who knows what would have happened had he been there, he was helping a 6 or 7 month pregnant Ethel Kennedy get off the stage. 50 years later, Bill Berry has not forgiven himself. He can't talk about it, and he was devastated because he thought that he should have taken those bullets instead of Bobby Kennedy. So rather than leaving you, though, on a note of what if, I want to say that if Bobby Kennedy were here, I can't be assured, he would have turned 90, by the way, last November, which makes me feel ancient, and anybody who remembers him still as looking that magical 42 years old. But if Bobby Kennedy were here tonight, what he would say is, I think he would deliver a message that was nonpartisan, and he wouldn't say, don't look back wistfully at who I was and what might have been. Take my values of what I was doing for America at that moment and the kind of coalition that we were assembling and take those out in the year 2016. And the coalition that he was assembling in 1968, to put him in contemporary terms, it was the so-called angry whites who were rallying to Donald Trump. And those were Bobby Kennedy supporters. In a later era, we called them Reagan Democrats. They were rallying to Bobby Kennedy from who they remembered he was in his early days. And they were Hillary Clinton liberals and African Americans and Hispanics. And he was on the verge, I think, of creating a coalition of bringing those groups together in a way that nobody who hadn't evolved politically the way that Bobby Kennedy did could have ever done. And so my dream, and I think Bobby Kennedy's dream, would have been that someday we are able to, in America, unite to the extent that these two groups can come together and get behind somebody who is authentic enough that they can believe in them. And I believe that you are a great audience, and thank you for being here tonight.
Thank you, Larry.